Howdy folks, welcome to Casual Saturday, and today, recommended by one of you guys in the comments of a previous video, I'm playing Atlantic Fleet. It's available on Steam and mobile devices for less than a tenner, and it's actually rather bloody good. It's a turn-based naval combat strategy game set, as the name would suggest, in the Atlantic Ocean during World War II. There are various different ways that you can play the game. What we're going to do to begin with is a naval battle. We're going to recreate the sinking of the British aircraft carrier HMS Glorious, along with her two destroyer escorts, the Ardent and the Acasta, at the hands of the two German battleships, the Scharnhorst and the Gneisenau, on the 8th of June 1940. Or at least, that's what actually happened. We're going to try to change history. The Germans in this scenario get the initiative, so they get to take the first shot, and wouldn't you bloody know it, the Scharnhorst has managed to score a lucky first hit with her first salvo. Gneisenau is turning broadside on, firing all three of her guns at the Glorious, and they fall short. Right, that was actually very lucky for the Scharnhorst, because the initial shots fired tend to be quite inaccurate until you've got the range. What we're going to do now is attempt to change history. I'm executing a hard turn to port and laying smoke in the Glorious, going to get her the hell out of there, and then we're going to lay smoke screens with the two destroyers, Acasta and Ardent, and we're going to close for torpedo attacks on the two German battleships. Historically, all three of the British ships were sunk, and the Gneisenau suffered some medium damage. We're going to see if we can change that. So, things to bear in mind. This is obviously a turn-based strategy game. If you're going to lay smoke, and any ship can lay smoke, it's just a question of throwing oil on the burners, then you can't take any other actions in that round. Ayy, another hit. I think the Scharnhorst must have taken their accuracy pills. Gneisenau opens up, and they fell well short. Oh well, that's good news. Right, my turn. Let's continue evasive manoeuvres in the Glorious and continue to lay smoke. Check out, great, my aircraft. The flight deck's out of action for the moment, although it is repairable, so we can't launch any torpedo bombs. Just checking the angle of the smoke screen. We're going to send one of the destroyers after the Scharnhorst and one after the Gneisenau. So we're executing a turn to starboard in the Acasta, and the Ardent can continue to lay smoke and carry on in this course. And hopefully that smoke screen is going to obscure the Glorious, allow us to repair the flight deck and get some aircraft. Oh, that's, well, I think that's the first time the Scharnhorst's fired and missed. The reason I say it's lucky that the Scharnhorst scored hits on their first two salvos is because gunnery during World War II, which is recreated quite accurately here, generally speaking, you're obviously trying to hit the target on your first shot, but your first shot is largely guesswork, aided by your fire directors. And what happens is the gun directors will observe the fall of shot from each turret. Each turret has its own gun director, and they will then pass corrections down to the turret crew. So what tends to happen is your first shot goes long, your second shot goes short, and that's when you know the third shot is going to hit. Well, I say shots, I mean salvos. You fire your first salvo and it would go long, so you drop the elevation on your guns, and that might go short or it might hit. If it hits, fantastic, you've got the range, keep firing. If it drops short, well, you've straddled the target, the next salvo should be bang on. So the Scharnhorst was exceptionally lucky to get some hits on the Glory, and yeah, this is more like it. The Gneisenau hasn't hit shit. That's what we like to see. Now, I could disengage, but I want to get the aircraft airborne. My anti-aircraft guns are still disabled, but the flight deck is ready to go on the Glorious. So, if I'm going to launch aircraft, I have to stop generating smoke, so that's going to make me easier to hit for a while. First, of course, it's the movement phase. So we're going to continue getting the hell away from these two German battleships. I'm just checking the various different smoke screens. I'm going to need to keep turning to port to get behind the smoke screen laid by the Acasta if I'm not going to be generating my own smoke here. And now I can launch aircraft, so fighters are no good to me. I want torpedo bombers. Now, you have to spend a turn readying the aircraft. And if your flight deck gets hit while you're readying the aircraft, it's go back to square one. So, closing the distance with the destroyers, and we're still generating smoke. Da-da-da. That should do. We hope. Scharnhorst's bringing all of her guns to bear. And... oh, you lucky German bastard! Damn it! Alright. And now the Gneisenau. And the Gneisenau is a clear shot. Oh, well, that's the closest the Gneisenau's gotten so far, but it's a little bit too close for comfort. So, I can't launch aircraft this turn. I'm just gonna... yeah. And my steering's damaged. Sorry, not my steering, my propulsion, so I'm slowing down. So screw this, we're going to generate smoke and just get the ship the hell out of here. Continue sailing evasively. The way the game models the increasing accuracy of your shots as you continue to fire at the same target is it makes the... how can I put this? The gun director will give you estimated elevation to the target, and as you continue firing at the same target and refine your target solution on that target, the predictions that the gun director gives you are increasingly accurate. So it does do a fairly good job of simulating how naval gunnery actually works. Scharnhorst's blazing away again, and yeah, good, okay. We're happy with that. Now the Gneisenau, opening up with all of her guns. And ooh, that was a hit. Yeah, I think the decision to screw the aircraft, lay smoke and get out of here was actually quite a good one. Unfortunately, the wind is not working in my favour. I've got a tailwind here, so the smoke is actually being laid straight ahead. And now my aircraft are completely out of action. Non-repairable. Great. So all I can really do with the Glorious is get her out of here. Now, when you've been in smoke for 3 rounds, providing you're far enough away from an enemy ship, you can disengage. I don't actually want to disengage the Glorious right now, because I want these two big German buggers to keep shooting at her, and not at these two destroyers, because the Glorious, with the flight deck out of action, is not going to be a threat to them, but they want to sink her, so she needs to stick around, basically to draw fire, which is going to allow the Acasta and the Ardent to get close and get some torpedoes away. That at least is the theory. Gneisenau firing again, and oh, this looks close. Ooh, was that... I don't think she got hit, but one of them was bloody close. Alright, we'll keep getting the Glorious out of here. Glorious was actually originally a World War I battlecruiser, light battlecruiser, courageous class. She was armed with 4 15-inch guns. She took part in the battle of the... on the second battle of the Heligoland Bight during World War I and was paid off after the war, but rebuilt in the 1920s as an aircraft carrier. And then she ran into the Scharnhorst and the Gneisenau in the North Sea in June 1940, and that was the end of the Glorious. Ardent and Acasta were two of the Royal Navy's A-class destroyers built during the 1920s. 18 were built for the Royal Navy and 2 for the Royal Canadian Navy. The two Canadian A-class destroyers were slightly different. They were basically modified to enable them to handle better in icy conditions. The bows were strengthened in case they had to break through pack ice, and they were modified so that buildup of ice on the upper deck wouldn't cause undue stability problems. A-class destroyers saw a lot of hard work during World War II. They were escort ships, and there just weren't enough escort ships to go around. HMS Codrington was bombed and sunk off Dover in 1940. Acasta and Ardent were obviously sunk by the Scharnhorst and Gneisenau. Acates was sunk by the Admiral Hipper in the Battle of the Barents Sea in 1942. HMS Arrow was so badly damaged by the explosion of a merchant ship that she was written off as a complete loss. HMS Acheron sank after hitting a mine off the Isle of Wight in 1940. The two Canadian ships, Saguenay and Skeena, the Saguenay was damaged in a collision in 1942. Repaired and could only be used as a training ship after that. And Skeena was wrecked in a storm off Kollafjord in Iceland in 1944. Here in Atlantic Fleet, however, the Acasta is about to bite back. We're about close enough to the Scharnhorst over there to get some torpedoes away. Now in the top right corner of the screen, you can see my firing indicators, the range, the elevation, the bearing, and so on and so on. Right at the bottom, you can see the torpedo bearing to target. And what I'm doing now is, in order to take into account for any evasive maneuvers taken by the Scharnhorst, I'm plotting a good old spread of torpedoes. I'm not firing them yet, I'm just plotting their course right across the predicted path of the Scharnhorst. Two torpedoes left. No. I'm trying to see if I can actually get some away at the Gneisenau here as well, but it's too far outside the firing arcs. So instead, we're just going to launch a salvo against the Scharnhorst. Now, this, of course, is assuming that the Scharnhorst does not make any radical course changes. And that's why you put a spread of torpedoes in the water to take that into account. The Ardent is going for the Gneisenau. So I'm going to keep laying smoke with the Ardent, because in order to fire the torpedoes, the Acasta had to stop generating smoke, which is going to make it a little easier for them to shoot at the Glorious, because the Acasta's smoke screen is no longer obscuring their view of the target. Gneisenau's taking a shot. That looks quite nasty. Yep, most of them fell short, but one landed square on the flight deck. So the Glorious is not launching any aircraft today. All she's really good for at the moment is to draw the fire of these two German battleships. Torpedoes running straight, that looks pretty good. If the Scharnhorst does not start maneuvering and changing speed very, very violently, she is going to get hit. Glorious still incapable of launching aircraft. I could disengage the Glorious right now, but she's still serving a purpose. She's still drawing the fire of the Scharnhorst and the Gneisenau. And since Ardent hasn't commenced her torpedo attack on the Gneisenau yet, we're going to keep her in play. Right, let's have a look at the angle of these smoke screens. Okay, we're going to pull hard turn to starboard and commence laying smoke. I could start shooting at these German ships with my 4.7-inch guns, but that would be a complete waste of time. We're not going to kill them with 4.7-inch guns. It's the torpedoes that are going to do the job, so more smoke. And now the Scharnhorst has switched to a secondary battery. She's recognised the threat posed by the Acasta just a little bit too late, but she has started to manoeuvre. Gneisenau still firing her main battery guns at the Glorious. The Scharnhorst's secondaries fell well short of the Acasta there, and the reason for that is because the gun directors are suddenly having to take a brand new set of plots in order to engage a new target. The first time you switch fire to a new target, the gun directors have to go back to scratch and get an estimated bearing and elevation. They will get more accurate the longer they keep firing at the same target. But the Acasta got away with that, despite the range, simply because the Scharnhorst had to switch to a new target. Glorious continuing to evade, continuing to lay smoke, and those torpedoes from the Acasta are looking very, very, very nice indeed. I'm highly tempted to start blazing away with 4.7-inch high explosive here, but it would be suicide at this kind of range. So instead, we'll just keep laying smoke. Moving closer with the Ardent. She's not quite in range. Well, I could fire torpedoes at this range against the Gneisenau, but I probably wouldn't hit. Scharnhorst secondaries becoming increasingly accurate. Gneisenau still firing at the Glorious. But she is presenting a very, very nice broadside on target to the Ardent there. I wonder if it's time. Let's see how these two... Oh, that looks very, very nice indeed. Very, very nice. Scharnhorst is sinking! Well, that escalated quickly. That looked like a magazine hit on the sea turret. So, one down, one to go. No, we're not going to disengage the Glorious yet, we're going to keep going. Again, she's still drawing fire from the Gneisenau. If only I had more torpedoes on the Acasta. Wait, I do have more torpedoes on the Acasta. I still have two left. So the Acasta is now going to stop generating smoke, and we're going to get a torpedo plot away at the Gneisenau. So, torpedo bearing is estimated at 271.2 degrees. Okay, the Gneisenau is going at some speed. So we're going to set the plot on the estimated bearing, but we'll vary it a little just in case the Gneisenau adjusts course and speed. It's only two torpedoes. There's one, and we'll adjust slightly, and there's two, and we'll get the torpedoes away. And now the Ardent. Continue on this course and speed, continue laying smoke for the Glorious. The Gneisenau still firing at the Glorious, ignoring the Acasta, which is fantastic news, and all the shots have fallen well short. Torpedoes continuing on their track. There's only the two of them. And soon it's time to keep moving and keep opening the range between the Glorious and the Gneisenau. Right. The Acasta's got no torpedoes left, and I'm not stupid enough to start shooting at a battleship with 4.7-inch destroyer guns. So, again, checking where she needs to be to get the smokescreen laid. And once again, we're going to use her as a decoy. Ardent's getting closer. I think we should be in a position to start launching torpedoes. Oh, Gneisenau's taking evasive manoeuvres. Still firing at the Glorious. Shots still landing nowhere nearer, thanks to the smoke screens laid by the destroyers. Torpedoes are looking reasonably good. Torpedo on the inside is probably going to miss, but the one on the outside might, due to the fact Gneisenau is making a turn to starboard. I'm going to swing the Acasta round, get a good layer of smoke between the Gneisenau and the Glorious. Yep, that's the job. Right then, Ardent, it's your turn. Going to keep moving, but we're going to turn now, while laying smoke, to get the torpedo launchers pointing at the second German battleship. And the Gneisenau is now firing at the Acasta with her secondaries, and that was uncomfortably close for a first salvo. Oh, I don't know, this looks... depends how fast the Gneisenau is going. Okay, it's probably... the second the Ardent has gotten the torpedoes away, it's going to be safe to disengage the Glorious and get her out of here. Acasta continuing to lay smoke, and hopefully the Gneisenau is going to continue shooting at the Acasta and not the Ardent, because the Ardent's the one with the torpedoes. But we're going to hold off on firing the Ardent's torpedoes just now. We're going to see what happens to the Acasta's torpedoes. Gneisenau switching fire to the Acasta. Secondary's opening up. Missed. Torpedoes. This is going to be good. This is going to be very good. That's taken out two gun turrets, sir. Gneisenau just lost A and B turrets. Only the C turret is still in action. There's still three guns, though. Right. Oh, well. Acasta, good job. You fired all of your torpedoes. Get the hell out of there. Keep laying smoke, of course. And now it's the turn of the Ardent. Here she is. Ardent, no longer laying smoke. Now we're going to get these torpedoes off into this wounded German battleship. So, we've got eight torpedoes to fire, and once again, we've selected the target. The torpedo bearing looks like about 52 degrees. So, and of course this is estimated, that's assuming the Gneisenau doesn't slow down or speed up or turn. So we're going to put a spread around that estimated torpedo plot. And I don't really see any sense in holding any torpedoes back. It's unfortunate that we couldn't actually get any aircraft away from the Glorious, because then I could show you the air attack. Which, I mean, I've played this scenario before. And the aircraft do not last long against the anti-aircraft firepower of two German battleships, I can tell you that much. Occasionally, however, they do survive long enough to get a torpedo away. But it's really the destroyers that the only thing they're going to save your ass in this particular scenario. So, torpedoes away. Gneisenau burning. Firing. Secondaries opening up. Gneisenau's got a nasty old list to port there. She seems to be taking on water. Many torpedoes in the water. Come on, Gneisenau. I think it's probably safe to disengage. But we're going to keep moving. We'll wait and see what happens. Acasta, you've done a great job, but keep laying that smoke. Keep turning. Keep sailing evasively. And you can start to retire. Now that Ardent has fired all of her torpedoes, we're going to break away and start laying smoke with her. Oh, wow. I wouldn't have thought the Gneisenau would have been able to continue manoeuvring at that kind of... I mean, considering the damage that she took. But then again, her rudder didn't get hit. And ooh. Ah. I think the Gneisenau might get away with this. I guess we're just going to have to wait and see. Historically, of course, the Glorious, the Acasta and the Ardent were all sunk. The Scharnhorst suffered medium damage, and the Gneisenau wasn't even scratched. Well, we've already changed history. We've sunk the Scharnhorst. We've inflicted some pretty heavy damage on the Gneisenau. Knocked out two of her gun turrets. And I think her secondaries are opening up, and they've missed again, which is always nice. But I think we might hit her with another two. Yes, two torpedoes in the bow of the ship. But she's not out. Well, we've got no more torpedoes to fire, so the Glorious's function of basically being a decoy for the Gneisenau's big guns has become largely redundant. I really should think about disengaging her and getting her out intact, because, well, the Gneisenau may only have one turret left with three guns, but Glorious has taken some hits. So, well, okay. Ooh, the Acasta's hit as well. Secondaries have finally found the range. It would be a shame if the Gneisenau was to sink the Glorious with a parting salvo, so we're going to disengage the Glorious. She's out. We've managed to successfully retire from the battle, although she has taken medium damage. The Gneisenau, however, let's have a quick look at the damage. The pumps are still out. A and B turret are done. So she's definitely sinking. I mean, you can tell just by looking at her that she's taken on water. She's got a list to port. The bow is down in the water. She doesn't appear to have any fires. This is where you have to make the decision. Are you going to disengage and get all your ships out alive, or are you going to stick around and wait to see if the Gneisenau sinks? I could engage her with 4.7-inch guns from the destroyers, but that would be suicide, because I'd have to stop laying smoke in order to do that. And, well, the Acasta's hit. The Ardent is busy falling back. The Gneisenau, their shots are getting too close to comfort on the Acasta. I really wouldn't want to lose one of these two destroyers just to stick around and see whether or not the Gneisenau sinks, because alright, at the moment she's taken on water, she's down by the bows, she's listing to one side, the pumps are out of action, so she's continuing to take on water. She may sink, but then she might repair the pumps, and she might start pumping the water out. And if I'm not generating smoke screens, I'm making myself an easy target for her secondary gun batteries. So, do I take the tactical victory and get out with my ships intact, or do I stick around and take the risk of seeing if the Gneisenau is going to sink? Her pumps are still out, and she is still taking water on, but I don't think it's worth the risk. Yeah, I think I'm going to withdraw. I'm going to get out with my ships intact. It's a tactical victory anyway, and the Acasta hasn't suffered any damage. The Ardent's only suffered light damage, and we've managed to sink the Scharnhorst. And it looks like that might have been the right decision, because the Glorious had suffered heavy damage, and one more shot may have been enough to sink her. So that's an outstanding victory for the Royal Navy. Stick that one up your pipe and smoke it, Admiral Dönitz, and jolly well done to the crew of Her Majesty's ship Acasta. Sank the Scharnhorst and inflicted substantial damage on the Gneisenau. Splice the main brace, chaps. The grog's on me. So, that was a quick look at Atlantic Fleet, and it really was a very quick look, because all we've done is one of the scenarios. There's multiple different ways of playing the game. You can play through a whole bunch of different World War II historical scenarios. There's also a campaign that you can play through, where The shipping that you sink rewards you with renown points that allows you to upgrade and purchase bigger and more powerful ships. There's also a dynamic campaign, which I haven't really gotten to grips with yet, but does look very, very promising, where you can play either as the Germans raiding the Atlantic convoys, or as the British attempting to defend the Atlantic convoys and react to various different threats that pop up, whether they be submarines or surface raiders, marshalling your limited resources and trying to minimise the amount of tonnage that the Germans manage to sink to the bottom. And of course, no game that attempts to simulate the Atlantic convoy battles in World War II would be complete without submarine warfare, or if you're playing as the British, anti-submarine warfare. Which is a coincidence, actually, because I just finished reading a biography of Captain Johnny Walker, who was the leading anti-submarine warfare expert of the Royal Navy during the early stages of World War II, and who developed tactics that were in no small part instrumental to the success of convoy operations in World War II. And reading the book and applying the tactics that Johnny Walker developed while sailing as a convoy escort leader in World War II has actually made me highly effective at dealing with submarines here in Atlantic Fleet. This really is a very, very good, cheap little game, and I really can't recommend it enough. So, that's Atlantic Fleet, available on Steam for PC and also mobile devices for less than the price of a cinema ticket. That's it for today's Casual Saturday video. I hope you enjoy the rest of your weekend, and as always, take care, and I'll catch you next time.